Any other members of the public that would wish to speak that haven't spoken so far? Okay. Seeing none, there, Mr. Jordan, you've already had a chance to speak.
I just have a very quick question.
Does it concern either aesthetics or safety?
Noise pollution.
Okay, go ahead.
I just, we had a question as to what the horsepower of the motor.
Please go back to the podium. When the public hearing is closed, I want to set one thing very straight. This board is not involved in the enforcement of the size of vessels, the noise of vessels directly. Those are water-related issues. And I want to be sure that everyone in this room understands that before you leave this evening.
They certainly have an impact on those of us that live very close to the water there, though.
Go ahead.
We never did get an answer as far as what the size of the engines were on that boat, for instance, and the noise pollution.
Yeah. Let me respond here. As to the noise, I think there are around 200 horsepower engines that are in a boat that size. And since I live on the water, I know about the noise, and those lobstermen come every morning with those lobster boats right in front of my house to pull their traps. And sometimes it's noisy, sometimes the foghorns from the ships are noisy, but this will be quieter than that, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Any other members of the public wish to comment? Seeing none, I'll close the public hearing. At this point, there have been many issues raised as part of the public hearing. And I'd like to quickly allow the opportunity for the applicant to respond to some of those issues, those that haven't already been answered.
I think there were two or three that I think were answered, and I'm not sure a couple of people understood, and I just want to emphasize Mr. Stockwell wanted to know what size boats, and I think that's been answered. He wanted to know whether the ramp would be deployed if Mr. Jellin was away on his boat, and what we want to do is try to make this very clear, we've tried before, that the ramp is retracted for all times except when Mr. Jellin needs to go get access to the water or back from the water to his house. Otherwise, it's retracted. So it isn't down unless he's going up it or down it.
Is there a switch indeed that when he leaves the dock that automatically retracts?
Yes, the boat. The boat sends a signal and it will retract.
Okay.
And a couple of things, I don't think they're important, but since they're factual, let me just say that the pier that was destroyed in the late 1970s was not the old casino pier. That was gone long before that. It was built right after World War II by Mr. Watson, who was a resident of the Cove, and he used it to tie up his boat. He was one of the few people in those days who had a cabin cruiser, and he used it to tie up his boat. The raft, I know Lloyd Knight did one, but long before he moved there, back before World War II, there was always a raft for the kids on the beach, and a fellow named George Albert, who lived in Cottage Lane, maintained that.
Okay. With that, I'll go back to the board. Any questions, any members of the board, or comments? Ms. Leidner?
Yes, just for the record, because there's been so many comments on the aesthetics, if perhaps Mr. Waterman can describe the actual anchoring mechanisms to secure the float, to describe the actual appearance of the ramp and the float, speaking coloration, materials used, and talk about what rust or corrosion problems might occur that could affect the mechanical workings of the ramp. And I think that's it right now.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Waterman?
Working backwards, so far as corrosion is concerned, the ramp is almost, the whole structure, other than the float itself, the whole retracting structure and the thing that holds it, is planned to be made of anodized aluminum. which is comparably non-corrosive. The cabling mechanism is mostly stainless steel. All of it is built in such a way that the pivots must be lubricated once a year with a grease gun to keep them running smoothly. That type of system, therefore, resembles such things as the cabling systems on boats, for example, boat steering cable systems, not to mention halyards on sailboats, etc. Corrosion is essentially only a problem then if there's negligence in its maintenance. As to the coloration, the aesthetic qualities, if I were to describe the way this ramp looks, it's a little difficult to do that in terms that everyone will understand. Nevertheless, let me start by saying that although this design is very revolutionary in its flexibility as regards retraction and instant coming out to meet the owner at his float and so forth, I have striven to make the appearance of this as traditional as can be done in that context. I don't want it to look like a space age contraption, which is because, well, I don't want to either, but Mr. Jelen doesn't want it to look like a space age contraption. We'd like it to look like a traditional boat ramp, except that I've tried to give it as gossamer a quality as I can. I've tried to keep its dimensions as minimal as I can, viewed from the side, so that someone standing on the beach or on a porch of a house in the cove looking at it doesn't see a great glob of mechanisms in the way of his view. I've tried to keep it simple, slender, and as more or less a see-through kind of a structure, which is essentially the way a good ramp is usually designed. In other words, it has something that you walk on, and then it has some handrails, and it has some material that goes up from the walkway to the handrails. And in this case, they have to be built in a special way so that they can collapse and disappear when the thing is retracted. But when they're up and in place, they will look rather like a normal boat ramp, but more delicate, I suppose, in appearance. As regards the mooring system for the float, there are 4 points at which it is secured. On the shore side, it will be secured to the ledge. On the ocean side, it will be secured to 2 large granite blocks. These granite blocks will be connected to the float by means of chains, galvanized chains, and these chains will be essentially, and the moorings themselves will be essentially the same kind of mooring and chains that is are found on many floats up and down the main coast. Incidentally, although I have moored many floats, including floats in harbors, I have never been in a situation where I was asked to consult with the harbor master as regards the mooring for floats. And this is something of an oddity, considering a mooring is a mooring, whether it's got a float at the top of the surface or a boat. So it's conceivable that the rules should be such that moorings are addressed by the harbor master, and we would certainly be happy to do that if anyone wishes us to do that. But I can simply say that based on my experience with putting floats in much worse situations than this situation, and I realize that this is a bad spot, that it does get a lot of swell, but I have floats in much worse situations than this. I have floats in virtually open ocean that are moored. I believe that it's simply a question of having a suitable size and length of chain, a suitable size and length, a size and weight of block on the bottom. And that's what I've got in mind.
Thank you. Could I just want to make a comment here. Again, I don't believe it's the planning board's purview to determine how a float or a raft is moored and the mechanical aspects of that. I believe that's either the harbor master or the code enforcement officer's purview. The concern that I would have as chairman of the board is to the domino effect that if the mooring of the raft, particularly in a tidal situation, in some way doesn't allow the proper interlocking of the gangway or ramp, there's a potential safety issue there to deal with. But that's the nature of the planning board's concerns. We're not marine engineers, and I don't think that we should be thought of being such. Judy, did you have any other questions?
I have a few. I don't think I'll ask all of them right now. Another one I would like answered, though, is that if Mr. Gellin decides to access his boats, he's pressing a button in his bedroom, the ramp comes down, he walks out there, is there a dinghy always moored out there that then carries him to his more distant boats? It's not clear to me. I now understand that the ramp will retract as soon as he leaves the flow.
Oh, when he has, he's not going to have his boats moored out there all of the time. He has slipped at Chandler's Wharf in Portland, and that's where his boats are going to be a good part of the time. Probably the sailboat will be at Maiden Cove more often. And to get to that sailboat, if he's going to use the sailboat on a particular day, he would leave a rubber inflatable to get out to it, because he's got to get out to the mooring somehow. So it would be a rubber inflatable.
So one could expect that a good part of the summer moored there if it wasn't actually tied out to the mooring.
Yeah, when he's there, Mr. Gellin travels a lot, so he's out of town a lot. So, but I think when he's in town and he's at that house, it's fair to say that there will be a rubber inflatable either on the float or either pulled up and turned over on the float or whatever.
Mr. Patius, perhaps you could describe the location of the public access point or points that the beach owners group uses to get to this beach. I assumed it's not right near Mr. Gellin's home.
No, it's over where the gentleman said where they come off Kenyon Lane next to Mr. Tyler's house. There's a little small road that goes down and to a path that goes on to the beach, and it comes off of Cottage Lane. So it's on the opposite side, almost the opposite side of the beach. Right, Bill? Yeah. It's in the middle of the crescent, I think that's fair to say.
Okay.
Mr. Gellin's house is at one end and Gibbons' house is at the other end.
I'm going to stop right now.
Okay. Anybody else have questions for Mr. Edson?
My questions deal with the safety issues. Maybe I missed something, and I'll ask George to come back, Mr. Waterman to come back to the podium if he could. You talked about the extender arm coming out, and as it comes down, my initial read of this was it was simply going to extend and come down on the float itself. Now, tonight you talked about a floating device necessary to carry 1,000 pounds because it's going to drop short of that at times. Or I assume all the time. Have you figured out how far short of the float it'll drop down?
Yes, it's a 50-foot ramp. It will drop down at about 25 to 30 feet away from the land.
How deep is the water there at low tide? Where the drop down is?
At a normal low tide, it's something like a foot and a half deep. On a drainer tide, there's no water there.
Okay. I'm just looking at the scale, and it's strictly, I think you've designed an intriguing device. I think you've designed something that is quite safe. This issue of it dropping down prior to this designation is something new tonight. And did I miss that, or is that something new to the other board members?
I thought it was landing on the float as well.
And the issue there is if there are children underneath or adults, for that matter. What's the total weight of that extender arm? The 50 scale shows it's 64 feet, but I mean, or approximately that.
The ramp is 50 feet, and its weight is approximately 1,000 pounds.
The total weight is 1,000.
Total weight, yes. So in other words,
so actually, it's the weight coming down wouldn't
would not exceed 500 pounds.
Okay. So you've got to have part of the drawing here is there's you don't show that little pontoon, if you will, that comes down, and you initially said it would be about 1,000-pound weight, which would take, about 20 cubic feet of displacement, I think. If it's 500 pounds, it would be down at 10.
Yeah, no, that was an error. 500 pounds is all you would need.
Okay.
And that would be, 20 cubic feet or so.
Mm-hmm. What's that design going to look like? I mean,
that's going to be contained in the ramp. You won't see it. You will see it if you look for it, you'll see it when it is deployed, because it's at the bottom end of the ramp, and it's designed and shaped like a pad.
I'm not trying to make my questions sound like they're dealing with minutia. It's just something that's new to the plan as far as where it comes down.
Yeah, when it's all the way out, that will be inside the float. You won't see it anymore.
So it's built to sort of pull into it? In other words, hop up onto the float? That part I just don't understand. How
it goes into it.
Into the float, okay. What's the length of the when it's fully retracted? I was quickly trying to see on the plan, how far does that little stub or whatever, what's left over, stick out from the actual porch of the house?
I believe it's 27 or 28 feet.
That's...
Yes, the...
Okay, so the 26-foot piece is...
Yes, that's the unretracted portion of the ramp. Well, it's actually totally retracted, but that's how far the support platform sticks out, and that's how far the upper fixed ramp sticks out. So there's a 26-foot extension that is fixed.
So fully retracted, it still protrudes from the porch 26 feet over the rock area?
That's correct, because there was not room for 50 feet of it underneath the house.
Let me just continue with that. Does that include both the sloped ramp piece, or does the upper ramp fold down with the lower ramp and they both retract, or does the upper ramp stay fixed?
Upper ramp stays fixed.
Okay. Go ahead, Steve.
The 26-foot piece that remains in place, is that like a sleeve that the extension slides out of?
There are two halves to it. The bottom half is a sleeve, and the top half is a walkway.
Okay. And it goes to a point of balance and then drops down to the water about 25, well, it's less than
30 feet probably, yeah.
Mm-hmm. When it anchors down.
After it passes the balance point.
Yeah. The question that I have of the planner, thank you very much, Mr. Warman.
You're welcome.
What's the jurisdiction of the Harbor Master? I have not a clue, not being a flatlander by birth.
The Harbor Master came in to see me late this afternoon and was curious about the project because he had received a lot of phone calls and came to look at things. He had a couple of comments. One that he had spoken to Mr. Jellin's representative some weeks ago and had issued permits for the two moorings that currently exist that are outside of Maiden Cove. He was a little surprised when he saw the dock because he said it's so close to land. He was curious how much use you would actually get out of it because there's very little water. You're not going to get much of a draft underneath it. And he's not sure he even has any jurisdiction to look at this. He basically issues permits for moorings for boats.
Okay. Just of interest also on the safety issue, did he concur or did you talk about the reason for his moorings being so far offshore is the size of the boats?
He said that Maiden Cove was crowded and there just wasn't any more room.
That's all my questions for now.
Thank you, Mr. Edsel. Mr. Carlson?
Yes, I have a question about the controls, the safety of those. One is located in Mr. Jellin's bedroom. Can he see the ramp from there? And also, when he pulls away from the dock with one of his boats, he has a remote, I assume, that returns that retractable section back underneath the house. Again, he's now 30, 40 feet away, maybe, when he's doing this. So I'm just concerned about the location of those controls and the visibility he has to watch what's going on.
Well, we say the bedroom. The bedroom, the first floor is the bedroom, the lowest floor, and it's where the deck is. So as you go out to where the deck is, it's all windows. You're looking at the ramp. You're right in front of the ramp. So where the button is where the ramp is. At the beginning of the ramp. It just happens to be inside the house, and that part of the house is all bedroom. That's
okay.
Number one.
Okay, while you're talking about that, a youngster or someone's outside, will he be able to yell to that person to say something's happening?
Oh, absolutely.
Or a warning device, a horn or something that might go in effect when that starts going?
No, there is no horn, but he's looking. I mean, when he's looking right there at where the ramp is going. He's right on top of it. Now, when he's leaving, I mean, my assumption is that he's going to use his noggin. He's going to get in the boat, and while he's there at the boat, he's going to retract. I hope that's what he does. I mean, is that the way it works, George?
Thank you.
Thank you. Does any other member of the board have any comments? Mr. Parkhurst.
We were told earlier in the presentation that at the front of the dock, the water would be 18 inches deep, but I don't think we were ever given a number at the back of the dock, the seaward side of the dock, how deep the water is there.
We have this problem at my house, which is on the harbor in Freeport. What I call the front, other people call the back. When we say there's 18 inches of water at the front, we mean the side that's towards the water, as opposed to the land side. At the land side, there's less water than that. That's at a mean low tide. At a mean low tide, the outer end of the float, the end of the float farthest from the house, farthest towards the water, will have approximately 18 inches of water. The shore end will have something like half that. On a drainer tide, the inshore end of the float is aground. There's no water there. You can step onto it from the land. The outer end of the float will have enough water to float a dinghy or a rubber boat, and that's it, a few inches.
So in 24 feet, the water only drops 9 inches?
Yeah, as a matter of fact, it drops... I'm not sure if that's right, but it's something like that. It drops 1.2 feet in 45 feet. And that would be about 3 inches, 15 inches. 15 inches in 45 feet, so you could say 5 inches in 15 feet, something like that.
Seems to run counter to my recollection of going swimming at that beach for 9 years of my life every summer. It seemed to drop off much more rapidly than that, but I may be wrong.
Well, I think that the slope varies quite a lot depending on where you are on the beach. And this particular spot, which is essentially a direct line from the northerly end of Mr. Jelen's house, not the extreme northerly end, but where the ramp is going to be affixed, straight out to the open water at the right end of, I think it's Ram Island, is that the island that's directly out there? If you proceed in that direction, I measured, the reason I talk about 1.2 feet is that I measured the distance from the where I knew the mean water line to be to the water line on that minus 1.2 foot tide, and the measurement was 45 feet.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Does anyone else have any questions or comments? Yes, Mark.
I have a question for the planner, and it concerns the issue of future use of such a structure. If a future owner went to the building inspector for a building permit to enlarge or an electrical permit for lights, does expansion of a site plan reviewed project then automatically require more site plan review?
Keep in mind that it's the code officer who determines when something requires review. But we do have a provision in the current ordinance that says that any amendment to an existing site plan requires review. So as long as it's something that the code officer feels is a change from the approval, it would require an amendment to that site plan approval. Now, depending on the extent of the change, it could be a de minimis change, which would essentially be approved by the planning board as a consent agenda item, or it could be a full-blown site plan review.
Thank you. I have one more question, this time for the applicant. And some of the discussion has revolved around the float, which used to be in the cove and was used by the public. And I think that the offer is a very a good offer by the applicant for public use of this float. However, times now aren't what they used to be many years ago, and I'm just wondering if you could address the sort of long-term prospects of liability for public use of what is essentially private property. Has the owners specifically taken that into account in granting this access?
Wait, the owner is given full consideration to whatever liabilities he may have and everything he does. Yes, the answer is yes.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I have a question for the town planner. It may sound kind of silly, but things may change in the future. It seems to me if this is approved, then any other person that owns land, that's beachfront land there, has the right to do the same thing at some point in time if they wish to do so. I don't know how many beachfront landowners are there. It's fairly dense between Mr. Jelen's house and Kenyon Lane emptying onto Casino Beach. It could look in the future fairly ridiculous there. I just wondered, do you know how many beachfront landowners there are on that beach?
They're all set back behind the high water mark, well behind, as you know, behind the beach. There is no way that they could get a retractable ramp over the entire beach and down below mean water. I mean, it would be prohibitive.
Okay, but is the issue here the fact that it's retractable? I mean, is there something that that does not permit?
Well, no. You asked
permanent structure.
No, but Mr. Parkhurst, you asked about is there anything to prevent somebody from doing something? Each project is different, and there would not be another project like this at that beach because it is physically impossible to have another project like this one. I could, come to you someday and want to build a dock in front of my house, and you'd have to obviously look at that differently. And it's the same with anybody else in Maiden Cove. They are in a totally different physical position. Mr. Jelen's house, as you know better than anybody, is over the water.
That answer your question?
It would be physically impossible to have a dock with these characteristics. It would not be, I mean, otherwise you'd have to, first of all, you'd have to plant, in order to get from the Sadloff Clucci house out into Maiden Cove, in the middle of the cove with a pier, you'd have to build pilings right through the middle of the beach. I mean, it's just a totally different situation. One, I don't see the planning board of, frankly, approving those kinds of things, but this is a unique situation. I don't think there's another house, I know there's no other house in all of Cape Elizabeth with the water coming underneath it. And I doubt that there's another house anywhere in the area with the water coming under it. It just uniquely lends itself to this type of arrangement.
Okay, a couple other comments, I guess, or whatever. The safety issue has been disturbing me ever since the beginning of this application. And I guess I'm getting more disturbed tonight as I hear more and more about this with a possible inflatable either rafted up to the dock or upside down on the dock. That to me is synonymous with an attractive nuisance for children. And I know, again, I hate to allude to my childhood, but there were dinghies on the beach, probably a dozen of them. We used to regularly bag them, go out and row around. We always knew who left their oars, who didn't. We go out and go wherever we wanted to go and come back. This to me is just too tempting. You wouldn't even have to drag the dinghy, just flop it off the dock and go. Excuse me. It just seems to me it's too inviting for children of all ages. And the fact that the dock, maybe at mean low tide, is grounded, and the parents down there with their really young children may not notice, just turning to talk to someone to grab another child. A child can walk 24 feet very quickly and be off the other end of that dock in 18 inches of water, which is certainly deep enough to drown a child in. And I have a lot of very, very grave concerns about the safety issue of this whole project. I don't begrudge Mr. Jelen his right to do this, but it doesn't seem to me it's been properly thought out from a public safety standpoint.
Any other comments? Mr. Edsel?
I think, I'm not an insurance underwriter, but I think the attractive nuisance thing is being thrown around a little bit lightly. I can't imagine this being deemed any type of attractive nuisance with the prevalence of dinghies and boats left around the shore, piers and docks typically are very prevalent along the shore. I don't know that any of those are deemed to be attractive nuisances. Again, I'm not an insurance underwriter. I don't know what that requires, but I think we're treating that a little lightly. And as far as what people do, whether children or adults, with other people's properties along the seashore or anywhere, they're responsible for their actions, whether they're children or adults. If they're children, then their parents should be responsible for their actions. We're asked during the public hearing to use some common sense in our interpretation of the ordinances, and this board does sit to regulate and enforce the ordinance. And we can only do that. I'm concerned about a lot of the property issues, the same property or ownership rights that gives Mr. Jelen the right to propose this are very similar rights to the people who come and use the beach. Those are property rights granted to the real property that they own. It happens that this site is sited in a way, unlike most of the others that surround the beach, that that affords this site a slight opportunity to accommodate this engineering feat. My own concerns still deal with some safety issues as to the working of this, and that the plan seems to have changed slightly, and I think, I don't see Mr. Waterman now. There he is. And before I feel comfortable voting on this, a representation of this landing pontoon. We're now told at mean low tide that I don't even know what a drainer tide is. You can tell I'm not a coastal person. Sounds like something from a bathtub. But there's no water, and I assume that the owner wouldn't use this thing at that time. But I also don't know how much water's there to, at a high tide whenever it's going to be used. I guess we'll get to comments about what we'd like to see as the different board members to further review the application. But I hope that the applicant would concur that there's some pieces to this, at least Mr. Waterman would concur that some pieces to the drawing here that have changed in the plan and in some of the engineering that required it to land a little bit short of the raft itself. And I think because those deal with safety issues and the potential being on a crowded beach, that by all rights we have a need to see what that would look like.
Thank you, Mr. Parkhurst. Any other comments or questions? I'm sorry, Mr. Edsel. Yes, Judy.
One question for Maureen. Do we have copies on file of Bureau of Public Lands, DEP, and Army Corps permits?
No.
We do not. Weren't those requests for your last meeting? I don't know how I feel about ultimate approval tonight, but in general, I can sympathize with neighbors not liking to see change. I'm one of those people that I believe firmly in public private property rights, but I hate to see any undeveloped property developed. To me, though, the bottom line is whoever owns it has those privileges associated with it, and I guess if I were in a nice position, I would own a lot of those properties that are more important to me. The standards that the board is using to weigh this project, while they do speak to the aesthetic impacts you've been talking about as homeowners, the words that we're dealing with are the impact shall not, for instance, unreasonably interfere with access or unreasonably interfere with an existing developed or natural beach area, or that these significant vistas shall be looked at in the context of the plan shall minimize the adverse impacts. We're certainly not able to look at the standards and say, well, there is some visual impact. Sorry, you can't do that. We do not have that authority as the board. Our hands are tied with legal standards we look at. And obviously, there's some interpretation, but it's not as cut and dry as I think some of you would hope. With respect to the safety of children on the beach, I live in Shore Acres and we have a wonderful little beach, not nearly as nice as yours, but I would not dream for a moment of taking my eyes away from my children with or without a float. And I think the suggestion that you could do that before this float was there troubles me greatly as a parent. If we were in a position to have a float in our cove, of course it would disturb the pure aesthetic enjoyment. I have that from a natural point of view, but as a patron of that beach, I would love to have something to swim out so I can see the people who favor it from that sort of public access point. And with respect to some of the comments of the boats that this would bring into the cove, I, as one board member, would have a hard time restricting this gentleman unless there are current legal restrictions for any one of us that we couldn't bring a particular size boat to within a certain distance of the beach if noisy engines were already prohibited and others weren't. If I couldn't bring some sort of boats and just ground them on the shore, unless those restrictions are already in place, I think it would be hard to ask Mr. Jelen to not be able to have the same privileges. For that, I'll
thank you, Ms. Leidner. Anyone else have any additional comments or questions? Mr. Wilcox?
I have a comment where the two areas that I'm also concerned with also are the safety issues, which I feel have been so far responsibly, if not absolutely 100% and guaranteed foolproof addressed. And the second is regarding the scenic vistas. I think the point that Judy just raised about reasonably impacting scenic vistas is one which is very well taken, because in everything that I've read and seen for DEP standards, for instance, impacts are always evaluated site-specifically, not just in terms of any addition, but for instance, does the addition break the tree line, stick up against the sky, does it blend in with other man-made structures, and blending in with man-made structures is one of the guidelines that all the literature that I've ever seen addresses with regard to shorefront zoning and also developing on sites that are visible because they're on hills or whatnot. And this one, in that respect, seems to sort of cluster the man-made together so that it doesn't impact the natural vista of the site as much as other conceivable types of intervention would.
Thank you, Mr. Wilcox. Any other comments? Mr. Carlson.
Just one real quick one to the planning officer. Will there be an approval, like a certificate of occupancy, or like an elevator has to be checked out to make sure it's safe for such an operation as this? Is there any further after if it's approved and it's built, is there any mechanism for approving that by the code enforcement officer?
Are you asking, is there a way to make sure that it gets done the way it's approved by the planning board?
That it meets what the planning stipulations that the planning board may make on approval?
If the board grants approval, the applicant will be required to pull a building permit. And after that, it's the code officer who's essentially responsible for making sure that what was approved is what gets built out at the site. The town engineer had made a recommendation that the design be stamped by an engineering professional or be otherwise approved by the building inspector. And the building inspector last month stated that he would be comfortable with the certification by Mr. Waterman. He's talked with some people at the state and feels that he's looked at Mr. Waterman's credentials and is comfortable with his level of ability to design the structure. Yeah, there are, the short answer is yes, there are some building permit follow-up things that will happen.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'd just like to take a brief moment. I did not introduce into the record, although it had been submitted to the planner, a letter from Joseph H. Groff representing the Cape Cottage Beach Association, and which I'll just read. Dear Mr. Emery, please be advised that as counsel for the Cape Cottage Beach Association, I would like to express the association's thanks for agreeing to hold a public hearing so that the association's members and others with any comments about this project can be heard. It was always the purpose of the Beach Association to make sure that all individuals that could be affected by this project have an opportunity to be informed and have the opportunity to comment. Last week, the Cape Cottage Beach Association had its annual meeting. The Cape Cottage Beach Association made a determination that as an entity, it will take no position as to this application. Implicit in this decision is, of course, the ability of any individual Beach Association member to express his or her personal position concerning this application. I guess we learned that this evening. Again, on behalf of the Cape Cottage Beach Association, thank you for having a public hearing on this matter. Very truly yours, Joseph H. Goff III. We also received a letter on June 8, 1994, which I believe was entered into the record at the completeness meeting. It is from John A. Ceraldo, and it regards the proposed dock of William Jellin. What I'd like to do is just simply leave this with the town planner, and if anyone would like to review it, could do so. I guess I have a lot of questions that get around the issue of safety and as well as the aesthetics. Let me start with the safety issues first. I'm not yet at a comfort level with the mechanical operations of this device, although I'm wonderfully intrigued by it. And it's such a unique device that I'm not sure that a structural engineer or mechanical engineer would be of much benefit in describing to us how it's going to work. I think it's truly your mastermind, so to speak. However, I think crucial to the safety concerns that we heard this evening, that we have to have a comfort level as to how it is going to operate. And I guess in our line of work, often what we do is a scale model that not only gives us an understanding of the implications of what it is we're designing, but also the relative impacts, how it looks. That would be one suggestion that I might come up with in demonstrating within that location how the device is proposed to work. It may be of benefit to you as well in terms of the final design and construction costs. I have a very general question in terms of how the device meets the float depending upon the tide situation. Is the float positioned at one location using vertical metal poles, or how is it fixed to adjust for the tide? How does the gangway know where it is essentially what I'm getting at in simple terms.
Yeah, okay. What you would like to see, I'm sure, is the same kind of security with regard to the float, the ramp finding the float, as you would have, for example, when two railroad cars couple themselves on a track. And this is essentially the way this works. If you observe the couplings in railroad cars, you notice that one half of the coupling is kind of a V-shaped opening, and it's V-shaped opening to make a correction for any slight missing of the target that there might be. In other words, as the other half of the couple comes in, it's directed by these sidewalls. We've all seen cruder examples of that when ferry boats try to come into docks, into their appointed place, particularly if there's a little rough water around, and they'll slam against one side and slam against the other, and then they'll eventually find their way into the right spot. But they do find their way to the right spot, and essentially the idea here is that we have a V-shaped opening and something that will center in that V.
Is the device designed such that it assumes that the design assumes that the float is at its farthest distance from the house, and at that point would be extended fully as the water rises or the float drifts in with the tide, the distance would theoretically be shorter, I suppose. I don't want to get into the design solution of it, but.
Well, I can tell you, I can boil that down for you very quickly. The float isn't going to move much. It will move, but it will move within a range of a couple of feet.
Okay.
And that's because it's held from four different directions, and it's held from far enough away so that the length of the tethering chains that hold it does not change much from high tide to low tide.
Again, I want to state that this board is not sitting here to judge the engineering qualities of the marine aspects of the project. However, the mooring of the float has something to do with the safety issues, since it's potentially on the beach at low tide. Those are concerns that I would have. I don't feel comfortable with the information that's been submitted to date that I can make a determination as to what all of the safety issues are related to the application. I don't believe there are any mooring locations shown for the float, particularly now that you've just addressed the issue that the chains have to be quite long. I don't know where the float is going to be tied with respect to the existing ledge, for example, whether that's in deeper water or that comes into the shallower ledge areas, I don't know. And those realistically could eventually have some impact in terms of safety. My understanding from the code enforcement officer is that with respect to the gangway, the initial 26 feet of gangway, which is of a limited width, the ordinance has a provision within the shoreline overlay zone or resource protection zone that provides for access to shoreline areas over stairways, and it's a custom that those are located throughout Cape Elizabeth, and there's no side yard provision. They're treated differently than another structure would be, and it's my understanding that's the interpretation the code enforcement officer has taken on the first 26 feet of ramp, because it does meet the minimum width requirements under that provision. So we're not treating that as an extension of the balcony or of the decks themselves. It's simply a way of accessing the water. With respect to swimmer safety, believe it or not, I was a lifeguard for several years, and people get real stupid next to water. They get unbelievably stupid when they get close to water. The further from Maine they travel, the dumber they get when they get close to water. I can say that because I lived out of state at one time. And the issue is ultimately is that there has to be either supervision. If swimmer safety is a concern, it would seem to me to be very reasonable, particularly in light of the ocean, that there are areas cordoned off with floats that describe the acceptable swimming limits at the beach. I don't want to tell the Beach Association how to provide safe swimming, but those are other considerations that would be taken into account in terms of safety. My concerns with safety are primarily with the functioning of this gangway. In terms of aesthetics, I suppose if I had a preference, I'd almost prefer to see a permanent pier there. I think a pier has a real elegance on the Maine coast, as does the gangway at the end of them in the float system. And I hate to think of the Maine coast having to be sanitized to the point we're not able to put piers in anymore and so forth. Main concern that I have with aesthetics is whether or not this thing is going to work as it's proposed to be working, that it will be retracted. In fact, I think that perhaps it would look better if it weren't retracted. My main concern is with this 26-foot diving board sticking out from the house. I would prefer to see it off a ledge or some other area, but I understand that's not part of the project. The accumulative effect here, however, is something that would be critical. As Mr. Parker has mentioned, what's to assure that other people aren't going to start putting in these types of devices? And I believe the applicant has stated that the physical restrictions and perhaps the financial restrictions as one assurance. Tied to all of this, however, I think is the good faith that we all have in the applicant, or the good faith that the applicant has expressed through testimony and through the written documentation. It's not clear to me at all how we would be guaranteed that when the house is sold, and I'll use the term when, that the next person is going to have the same restrictions or have the same good relationships with the Cottage Beach Association, and that's something that I feel needs to be discussed, and if it can't be addressed tonight, should be reviewed and suggested at another meeting. I guess I have other concerns, but those are really the more critical issues. Mr. Parker, Mr. Edsel.
Chairman, I just want to summarize my concerns because I see this coming back one more time. As one board member, I'm not convinced that you've substantially satisfied the safety issues as far as the apparatus is concerned. I look from the May 1994 drawing to the June 94 drawing, and it appears that there's a pivot in this 50-foot. Is that a pivoted 50-foot extender arm that goes out? Shows a pivot at inshore end of extendable ramp shown at partial extension. My reasoning is that I'm trying to see how this thing works and actually touches down. You've got a ramp above, you've got this extension ladder model basically, and above that coming off from the porch you have a ramp coming down to that. So as this goes out it reaches a fulcrum point and starts to tip at 25 feet or whatever the balance point is. But above it is this ramp coming down from the porch. There doesn't seem to be any mechanism to keep it, you know, otherwise it bumps underneath the porch and it bumps up underneath the ramp and slowly slides out there. And then sort of very quickly drops at almost full extension, full 1,000 pounds as it comes down to the water, because it's inhibited from dropping from the ramp above that? Or do we have a pivoted extension arm pivoted at 25 feet? That being the case, you have this, the extension ladder scenario again where it goes out 25 feet and then it's dead weight drop of 500 pounds down. I guess from the drawings, you don't need to clarify that tonight for me, but when you come back, it's got to make sense of how this thing actually comes out. Other safety issues involved with this whole plan, I think you've answered in this one board member's mind's eye the substantial safety issues involved in the float and the other parts of the project. It's simple, the operations of this, how it actually drops down without causing a safety issue for other people using the beach, which is their property right to utilize the beach as well.
Thank you, Mr. Edson. Anyone else? Does anyone wish to offer a motion? Ms. Lardner?
I'll propose the following motion for the board to consider. That be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of William Jellin for an RP3 permit, section 19-39 of the Wetlands Regulations and section 6-6-3 of the floodplain ordinance, and site plan review section 19-2-10 site plan regulations, and section 19-3-6C of the shoreline zoning to construct a gangway and boat float extending from his home located at 11 Birchnell's Road be tabled. The applicant is requested to provide for the next board meeting the following materials: all required approvals and permits from other agencies such as the DEP, Army Corps of Engineers, and the Bureau of Public Lands, the location of the moorings for the float and nearby moorings in the cove, a statement from the harbor master with respect to his jurisdiction over the project, and detailed drawings of the gangway, both retracted and extended, and the boat float.
Second.
Motion has been seconded. Any discussions on the motion? Ms. Lardner.
Just for the record, Tom, I'd like to echo a comment. I don't see the concern with this not being a permanent facility and being fully extended. If there is a strong reason, rationale on the part of the applicant or concerns about this from the people that use the beach, I would certainly be willing to entertain at the next meeting conditions that would limit when that could be extended. And to specify that any change in the design, operation, or use of this structure has to come before the planning board and that the various restrictions be recorded in the registry of deeds, just in general. So maybe the applicant can consider.
I missed the first part of your comment. You would or you would not object to it being permanently deployed?
In general, I don't see the concern why it wouldn't be permanently deployed or a design of a permanent dock. I also don't know a lot about that, but it is, I think, a charming part of the coast and a sensible part of the coast. But if there are these legitimate reasons to have a retractable facility, that I think we might rightly want to consider some restrictions on the use.
I think, if I can interrupt, just there may be some issues. The very few ramps, boat ramps, actually come right off out of somebody's personal residence, off their porch they usually come up to another level and then you walk from there up to your home. This is a case of not only privacy but safety of the resident, that people just simply walk on the float and then walk up this ramp into his bedroom. I think there's a safety issue for the owner that he doesn't want it to be out there very much.
Yeah, I'm not urging that. I just, yeah. In general, a lot of comments were against it being extended.
Yeah, I have a problem with the visual effect of a boat ramp or float along the coast of Maine.
Any other comments on the motion?
I just want to urge all the board members, if there are issues that you want to make sure that are covered, that we don't always list these as part of the tabling motion. We sort of summarize them, but if we do, then I think we need to be prepared that when we come back, in all fairness to the applicant, if we're listing those things that we're asking, that we list all of those things to be considered, not get out 30 days from now and say, oh yeah, by the way, we meant to include this. If we are actually, as part of the motion, going to list them, let's make sure that we get them all so it's fair.
Excuse me, just a moment. Yes, Ms. Lodge.
I just wanted to add one thing that I forgot. I did intend that those drawings show the conditions at both mean low and high tides.
And I will add one more comment with respect to Mr. Edsel's and Ms. Lardner's comments. There was a lot of discussion tonight about timing of the activity of extending and withdrawing the device. It's my understanding there are no lights that will be used either on the raft or on the gangways. If such, it seems to me that it could be quite hazardous to have this thing operating after dark. If there's any discussion about time restrictions or use, I would also like to have the applicant make an argument one way or the other if there's a concern about restricting night use.
Okay. I would just want to voice a balancing effect on the board, perhaps, that the applicant knows that while there's been some mention of restrictions and deeded restrictions that carry with the property, that as one board member, I'm not necessarily in favor of making those required deed restrictions for subsequent owners. I'm not sure that we ever do that in private property issues as far as operations of private property. We typically do with commercial site plan review when it deals with a business that we have certain deed restrictions. I'm trying to think of examples where we would make as a condition of approval deed restrictions that carry with operations the use of a pier. I'm just saying, as one board member, I'm not necessarily in agreement with that, but need to take it into account.
Okay. One quick comment. However, this is the only, if I'm not mistaken, the only pier, dock, whatever you would want to call it, in the town of Cape Elizabeth. I'm not aware of another. I may be mistaken.
I'm not sure whether it is or not, but I still don't know whether this board is in a position to require deed restrictions for subsequent owners. You know, when we don't impose conditions to subsequent owners of the other beach interests they carry with the site, simply because this person has a dock.
If I can digress just for a second, when I was a child growing up on this beach, I had a friend who has since deceased, but he thought it was a great thrill one day to go to the Watson's dock and see how fast he could going on his bicycle and rode off the end of it at low tide. And he was lucky enough to separate himself from his bicycle before he hit the water, because he probably would have been killed then. And I just, you know, thoughts of these kind of crazy things that kids can do keep running through my mind. And I think it's critical that this dock not be accessible at any time that the owner is not there to oversee it, because it is so readily accessible from the beach, from the water, and I would think from a safety issue for his own security of his home, he would want that as well.
Are you talking about the gangway itself?
Yeah.
One way of doing that would be obviously the assurances that it would be retracted when it's not in use. I'd like to close the discussion here fairly quickly, but I'd like to also emphasize, we talked about aesthetics and safety. I also don't believe that the world should be flat and soft. We design the world to be flat and soft every day, and we protect our children to a point that is going to make it very dangerous for them to go to major cities at some point. And I, as Judy said earlier, I fully respect the right of a private citizen. And I don't think that everything that we look at should be looked at with the concern of what someone is going to do in the worst case situation, including my own brothers, including myself and anyone else. Most of us tend to make it to adulthood. It's a miracle, but we do. I'll leave that at that. At this point, we have a motion, and it's been seconded. I saw the applicant had his hand up earlier. Do you have any additional comments at this time?
Mr. Chairman, I recognize what's about to happen here, and I would ask the board's consideration of just one thing. The applicant, it is now summertime, and it takes 30 days at least to construct this, so if there's any opportunity for you to deal with this at another meeting earlier rather than later, we would appreciate it, because otherwise it looks like it will be another year for Mr. Jelen. He's not going to use this in September and October.
Let me, I can't promise you that. We are normally scheduled July meeting is canceled, workshop meeting is canceled. That would be the most likely time that we would schedule special meeting. The other issue is that we have requested additional information with respect to the design of the facility this evening. The information that was requested last time arrived, I don't know if it was late, but it was certainly at the last minute. And are you convinced that you can prepare the materials that we've requested in time for an early meeting?
We feel it's very important for Mr. Jelen to, if he's going to have this. If he's not going to have it, he's not going to have it. That's the end of it. If he is going to have it, we'd like him to have it this year. And we would get the information to you, George, today is Tuesday, Friday. Everything you need.
Did I just hear George swallow?
Well, I think there's a reason to do this.
He swallow.
There's a reason to do this, Mr. Chairman, and we'll do it.
Mm-hmm. How does the board feel about a special meeting for this applicant?
I think we're legally bound by notification of public meeting to a certain time frame, and I'm not sure what it is, 10 days notice?
You really shouldn't plan on anything more than 2 weeks from now.
Okay. Yeah, we canceled our normally scheduled workshop date because it's, what, the 5th of July?
Mm-hmm.
And we're not typically here. If as one board member, I would say that as long as it's not scheduled on the 4th of July, and the applicant can fully submit the information that we've requested, as one person, I would be willing to sit for meaning if the planner feels that she can get this publicly noticed appropriately.
Well, first of all, does it have to be a public notice?
No.
It's not a, we've had the public hearing.
Okay.
My concern is I'd like to have the information complete, and I'd like to have the planner and the appropriate town staff have an adequate time to review it and comment on it so we're not faced with another tabling situation. It would seem to me that we couldn't improve the schedule by much more than 2 weeks. I'm thinking that something after the 5th of July would be more reasonable in terms of the town staff.
Only if you want me here.
Hmm?
Only if you want me here.
Why don't we do this? Why don't we proceed with a motion, vote on the motion, and then decide when the next meeting will be? On the motion. We have a motion that's been seconded. All those in favor, please indicate by raising your right hand. Motion passes unanimously. Now, with respect to the next meeting, I'll ask for the planner when she feels the applicant has said that the material will be here on Friday. Today is Tuesday. When would it be reasonable for you to distribute the information to the department heads, review it with a code enforcement officer, and get packages out to us so we have a reasonable review?
Oh, if I get the stuff by, I assume by the end of day Friday, it would go out Monday to department heads. And I could probably get comments back from them the same week, so a week from this Friday.
Which is still in June.
That's right. It's I think it's July 1st.
Okay. The town planner cannot be available for the July 5th meeting. I would prefer to postpone it another week to July 12th.
I remember having at least one special meeting, but I can't for the life of me figure out why we did that. And I'm curious what precedent we have for accommodating people in this way.
You had a project with a wetlands alteration permit down at the end of Hanford Cove Road and scheduled a special meeting for that in order to allow the applicants time to do seeding and revegetation before the growing season ended.
Is that the only one you can think of?
You may have had another one. That's the one that comes to mind most quickly. I think you've done it once before, but
I think what I'll do at this point is I have a lot of concern about the ability for the public to, although it won't be a formal public hearing, it's not necessary to have a formal public hearing. I have concerns that the public have adequate time to review the material, as well as town staff, and express comments to staff and to the planning board, in other words, in whatever way is determined appropriate for the next meeting. The other issue was, in fact, an emergency wetland alteration permit. The site was opened and under construction, and we wanted to see it closed and revegetated it before the fall growing season. I don't know that there's a great public benefit to be served in having an early meeting. With all due respect to your client and the summer schedule, I know how frustrating it is to have invested the time and the money into both the design as well as the existing house. But I'm not sure that we have a public concern here that warrants having a special meeting. That would be my opinion.
But I think this board tries to accommodate public, the applicant's wishes. I mean, we are certainly, the site plan reviews that we deal with are driven by the climate in which we live. We try, this is a town board that we try to accommodate people. We've chosen not to meet on the 5th of July because the planner is not here and it's close to the 4th of July holiday. I'd like to see if we could accommodate, well, go by the consensus of the board for one thing, but we're on the 21st of June. We get it on the 24th, goes out, return, let's say, from the department heads by the 28th, 29th of the following week. Puts us into a holiday weekend. We're still looking at a meeting sometime between, say, the 5th and the 12th of July. I think if the applicant is willing to meet, and when are you returning, Maureen?
It's the first full week in July. I won't be around, so I think it's like the,
be back the 11th.
The 11th,
so.
Yeah.
Okay. Right. Again, the concern, and I'll leave it up for discussion of the board, the concern I have is that we had a lot of public comment tonight, more than we've had on any other project in this community, including the middle school $11.7 million community school expansion. And if we short-circuit the process at this point and the public feels left out, they're going to feel that something's going on behind closed doors at Town Hall, and I don't want that sort of
I just feeling. You know, the time still accommodates a chance for public notice. We can still get issued information into the Cape Courier by the 24th, which is this Friday, I believe. Even though we're not required to, it means it would be the application, the new information, we'd be back on. Which desk is it usually left at? The assessor's for public review?
Oh, yeah, it's all in my office, but my office isn't locked. Anyone can walk
in. Well, it could be left at whatever public location, yep, for public review as early as...
as soon as it's received.
Right. I mean, certainly as much time as we have to review it.
Okay. How does the board feel on this matter? Ms. Ladner?
While I can appreciate accommodating this applicant, I think we've heard other applicants before, especially talk about an end of a paving season or end of revegetation, and I feel uncomfortable setting this as a precedent just to accommodate an applicant when I think then fairly we should accommodate anyone else who makes a request that, you know, it's going to cost them more money if they have to push off construction for a month. So on, as you said, Tom, unless there was a real overriding public interest, I feel a little uncomfortable playing with the schedule.
Anyone else?
I think I have to echo that as well. It seems like we're going out of our way just because of our very short summer season here.
Peter or Roy, do you have any opinions?
No, I just have, I guess I do have a comment about how much involved the board should be in the design of the pier, of the dock. And the bottom line is the structure. And I can see us going on for several meetings if we're going to get into design review. I myself am not too well acquainted with that. And it seems to me when somebody submits something, we approve it. And I did ask earlier tonight about, do we have a check on this project, that being the approvals by the code enforcement officer and the town engineer. So I think the question before the board is, should this project be permitted based on what's in our books?
Mm-hmm.
So.
I'd just like to echo Mr. Council's remarks, and also that on my personal basis, I have no objections to an extra meeting in early July.
Thank you. Mr. Wilcox?
I have no objection to an extra meeting either.
The extra, if we, I would just soon put this to a vote. When would the extra meeting be? Give us a date. The 12th?
The 12th.
Okay. All those in favor of not, of an extra meeting, please indicate by raising your right hand.
No, what was that again?
All those in favor of an extra meeting or a special meeting on the 12th, please indicate so by raising your right hand.
Quick question. Is our regular meeting the 19th? Mm-hmm. Just in perspective. Okay.
So, I guess the question of the applicant, is a one-week advantage significant?
It is. We were most anxious to do this, but we just don't want to go another year. We have reasons.
I guess my question is, if the board is willing to set up a special meeting, is the best we can do, due to a number of different things, getting the submission, getting it to department heads, getting a chance to review it ourselves, a holiday falling in the middle, the best time we can get is the 12th. Is that, you know?
We appreciate the willingness of the board to consider even that 1 week advantage. I think that's very important to Mr. John. Otherwise, we'll probably go to another year. And we would prefer not to do that.
Would there still be a regular meeting on the 19th?
I know of two projects that are expecting. I know one definitely, probably two, actually maybe three projects that are expecting to come in on the 19th. One of them, they may want to jump on the 12th just because they're that close to being ready. So,
okay. Well. Question again, who would favor having a meeting on the 12th?
Ken Altman's vote.
Those against? So the request is denied, and the next you'll be seen at the next regularly scheduled meeting of the Planning Board. That's the last item on tonight's agenda under old business. Are there any other comments the board wishes to make? Do I hear a motion?
Motion to close the meeting.
Just Ms. Lardner had a
quick comment. I'm sure we all saw that Mr. Wilcox recently was noted in the paper for some honors, and I would like to compliment him in public for those.
One would not expect less from a GSD graduate. Congratulations.
Thank you.
I'll second Stephen's motion.
All those in favor? Meeting's adjourned.